This is Chapter 4, Immune, from Memorizing Pharmacology. I'm going to talk about the cephalosporins, first versus third, fourth, and fifth generation, and just go over a summary of what it is to go up the generations and why it matters. If you haven't seen this in order, you're not seeing this after the penicillins, because penicillins and cephalosporins both affect the cell wall. So often penicillins, cephalosporins, vancomycin, and fosfomycin end up together. Just a reminder, cephalosporin, and I know this picture says penicillin, also has a beta-lactam ring, and again, we call that beta-lactamase the enzyme that destroys the ring, but in this case, rather than penicillinase for a penicillin, it would be cephalosporinase, the enzyme that destroys the ring in cephalosporin in some resistant bacteria. What do we get when we go up the generations? So as we go up the generations, generally we gain some gram-negative coverage, and there's some exceptions to this because there's some gram-negative, gram-positive coverage when you start to get it to the, you know, fourth generation and so on. But remember, gram-negative means that the stain didn't go in, and the stain didn't go in because there's that third layer. And if you want to think of, you know, grandparents like to put that plastic on their couches. If you think of that third layer as that plastic on the couch that nothing gets through, that would be a good analogy for the gram-negative or the difficulty killing a gram-negative organism. Then CNS penetration, that improves as well. So if you see some kind of meningeal infection or something like that. And then beta-lactamase resistance. So a first-generation medication would have very little beta-lactamase resistance, and the bacteria wouldn't be affected by, say, Cefalexin or something like that. But as you get to the third, fourth, and fifth, you're looking at very good beta-lactamase resistance, so against those cephalosporin ACEs. Let's look at the medications themselves. So the first generation cephalosporin, and there are many in each generation, but what we want to do again is we're just setting up the framework, and we can always remember things in addition to what we have, but we want to have a framework for the generations. Now, why didn't I put 5 here? The difference between first and second isn't really a ton, and I want to stick with 4 questions. So the real change comes from first to third generation with those 3 things I mentioned before. So the first generation cephalosporin, Cefalexin, this is the only one that would come PO of the 4 that we see here, and that's brand Ceflex. Note the CEPH rather than CEF stem. The third generation cephalosporin, IMIV Ceftriaxone, which is Rocephin. And that name, that brand name came from, I believe, Roche Pharmaceuticals. Fourth generation cephalosporin, IVIM, Cefapime, Maxapime. When they were making this medication, they thought it was the maximum generation, but that was not the case. And we now have fifth generation. And what's interesting about the fifth generation, Ceftaroline, and I've heard Tefloro as the brand name pronunciation, but it's actually really hard to find brand name pronunciations. So we'll stick with Ceftaroline. That's what I see in the respected resources. And this is fifth generation, and we'll see what happens as we go from generation to generation. What are the changes? What are the things that are unique? So a patient needs a first-generation cephalosporin. Which do you choose? Obviously, it's ridiculous when you have, you know, all the generations there. It's going to be A. But let's change it to their generic names. And I don't know if you would see the question in this way, but this is what you want to have mentally, that Cefalexin is first generation, Ceftriaxone third, Cefapime fourth, and Ceftaroline fifth. Now, I put them in order in this because my videos are meant to help you memorize them. And then when you get to your big book of questions and all of that, you can remember what order they were in from this video. But we look at this and we say, okay, well, how can I remember the generations? And there are a couple of videos out there on remembering them. But you want to start with the ones that are relatively easy to remember. So Cefalexin, it's first generation, and it's the only one that has that CEPH. And if you can think of it as an archaic term, a term that's used before, but it didn't really make sense to use it that way because PH is problematic with pronunciation and spelling, and also it refers to head if you're thinking about medical terminology. So that's a little bit misleading. So that's how I remember cephalexin with the CEPH for the first. The ceftriaxone, I recognize the TRI for like a tricycle that has three wheels. And cefepime, I think of maxipime and maximum prison. So there's an M-A-X-I-P in the brand name. And in a maximum prison, you would have four walls. So that's how I remember fourth generation cefepime. And ceftaroline, this is fifth generation. And it's got an interesting stem in that if you go to fifth generation, it's not only the CEF, but the OL substem in the middle that lets you know that, okay, this is a fifth generation cephalosporin. So I remember there are five letters in that stem, the CEF from the cephalosporin class, and then the OL that's added to that as a substem. So five letters altogether to remember that's fifth generation. And that's really where you want to start is on the immediate recognition should be what generation is a cephalosporin, because that has a lot to do with what it's good for. So let's go to practice question three. We'll now do the drug names, and we can just, this might be a straightforward question. You might see this a number of different ways, but a patient needs a PO cephalosporin for otitis media. You can change the condition, but this is the only PO medication in this group, or the only one that comes PO. So that's a relatively straightforward one. But let's try to make B correct. Let's go to the third generation ceftriaxone, which in the practice questions I've seen, I usually see it as the adverse effects rather than the positive effects or the what it's really good for in terms of coverage. So which cephalosporin would be of most concern with warfarin, brand Coumadin? So again, we look at the stem and we see the F-A-R-I-N. So we know this is an anticoagulant. And ceftriaxone has a severe interaction, can cause bleeding with an anticoagulant. Now, you could think of the axe in ceftriaxone and think of, you know, Edgar Allan Poe and the bloody axe or something like that. But you have to be careful because you have to know all of the cephalosporins to make sure that there's not another axe in another one. And there is one that has tax in the middle. So I don't know if that's the best one to use to remember the bleeding interaction. But again, this is a severe interaction. Now, how could I change the question to make it the same answer, but just a little bit different question? Well, we could just say, all right, well, what's another anticoagulant? And the same thing would be true with heparin. So heparin, warfarin, both would expose that ceftriaxone bleeding interaction. So let's make cefepime the right answer. So how do we make C correct? Okay. Cefepime is really good coverage against a nosocomial pseudomonas infection. We remember that nosocomial means coming from the hospital or really the health system. It's not necessarily a hospital. And cefepime, which is the fourth generation, would be good for something like that. And more generally, that's really where the difficulty of the exam comes. How hard will the test makers make it? And if you think about the way tests, when you're talking about standardized tests, they put out questions ahead of time, see how students do on them as practice ones, and then see if they're going to put them in. So it has to be common knowledge. So when you're talking about cefepime fourth generation, nosocomial pseudomonas is probably common knowledge. But when you get to some of the other coverages, it might not be. So that's really where we want to start. What's the common or unique trait that makes this a valuable addition to the hospital formulary? Because they don't add things to the formulary if there's already something cheaper, better, that's already there. And then to finish up, how do we make D correct? So ceftaroline is special in that it does have coverage for methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus or MRSA, MRSA, and that's what makes it so special. So again, the generations are the key to knowing what it is that these medications are for. Cephalexin, really that it's first generation PO, it's not really used too much for active infections because of its limitation against beta-lactamase. Ceftriaxone, we're looking at the bleeding issue as one of its problems. And, you know, I could have said community-acquired pneumonia or something like that. And then that's where we kind of get into complications where it could be, you know, third generation, fourth generation, fifth generation. So we really want to try to stick with the unique ones as we're trying to learn our foundation here. And then cefepime was supposed to be the maximum fourth generation, and it didn't end up being that way. But remember, this is good for those nosocomial Pseudomonas infections. And then ceftaroline for the methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus, the MRSA, that fifth generation, newest generation.